everyone. Welcome to Dead Reckoning Radio, the February 19th edition, 2016. I'm your host, Jay Friesen, in the studio as usual with the high-heeled and pregnant Hadley Heath. And the... Brian. Oh my word. He always takes off right when we start the show.
So, Jay, sometimes when you start the show, you sound kind of exasperated. Like, you sound like you're not happy. Like, welcome to Dead Reckoning.
I'm totally happy. My radio voice gets a little weird. I've got that radio voice. If you talk to me, I mumble in the radio. Anyway, while Brian gets back, DR Radio is a weekly live stream helping you intelligently engage with critical cultural moments from a distinctly Christian perspective. And we have a great show for you today. Our three main topics: the ramifications of Justice Scalia's death and what that means for a generation of Americans, Apple's rebuffing of the FBI's request to build a backdoor into the operating systems. Is a government backdoor the wisest move? And yes, there are some guiding Christian principles we can apply here. And finally, some thoughts on the Trump versus Pope madness. As always, we'll take a break from the heavy and inject a bit of wit and whimsy throughout the show with nerd versus nerd and spy versus spy. This is going to be really great. It's exciting. We're happy. If you're listening in for the first time on our 5-star rated podcast, guys, welcome. And if you have done so, please add to that rating. We do the show in front of a live worldwide web audience. And those of you on the live stream, we salute you and look forward to what your banter will bring to the show. A little AC/DC reference. So before we start the show, a few quick takes. Thank you to our sponsors, Alliance Defending Freedom, defending your right to freely live out your faith. adflegal.org. Those guys are great. If you'd like to sponsor us, shoot us a note at hello@deadreckoning.tv. Guys, to start the show, the death of Harper Lee died in her sleep at age 89.
The loss of one of the great American writers, and it's actually kind of odd to say that about somebody who really published one book in her entire career. To Kill a Mockingbird, but that one book was arguably the greatest American novel, and certainly one of the most consequential novels written in the 20th century. There have been few books that have had the impact that Harper Lee's To Kill a Mockingbird had. I think probably Uncle Tom's Cabin by Harriet Beecher Stowe comes to mind, tackling the problems of race in the 1860s, and Harper Lee, of course, dealing with the issues of race in the pre-civil rights era. Fantastic book. She will be missed. She was a very private person, never gave interviews, was stayed out of the limelight. She was a one-hit wonder, but what a hit.
It's true. Hadley, Rhonda Rousey said on Ellen...
No. She wants to say something about
I don't have anything to say about Harper Lee. It's fine. No, moving on.
This is quick takes. I'm going to go back and forth. Rhonda Rousey at The Ellen Show said she contemplated suicide after losing her title match to Holly Holm. Yeah. Thoughts of motherhood actually got her out of it. Do you think this is feminists rejoice everywhere, or is this a terrible thing? A woman fighter wants to be a mother.
Yeah. I honestly hadn't thought about it through the feminist lens so much as I thought about it through, just as a Christian, and I don't know how many other people have shared this experience where she says, if I'm not this, what am I? Because she was talking about being a victor in the boxing ring, or I guess whatever kind of
the cage.
I'm so ignorant. I don't know if she does mixed martial arts or what it's called, but she said, if I'm not this, what am I? And, you know, I think while motherhood and love relationships are profound and wonderful things, to my mind, she was sort of just changing her idol from one thing to another, because we're not promised motherhood either, you know, that ultimately I hope she finds her identity in Christ, that she knows that she's a child of God and that she can be redeemed, and maybe she's a Christian, I don't know, but I just thought, man, motherhood's another thing that I think, you know, we're tempted to put our identity in as women, that ultimately it's not even the root of our identity. You know, the root of our identity is being a child of God and a redeemed sister in the family of God. So I was moved by it, and I thought it's important for someone with the fame and recognition like Ronda Rousey to say even she struggles with her identity sometimes. But I'm not sure that I agree that she's found the right direction to move forward.
Yeah, it's interesting how that incident on Ellen kind of teaches two things. Number one, how we are not self-sufficient. We need our identity to come from somewhere else, right? So she has this experience of, if I'm not this, what am I? And it's something outside of herself that, turns her outward instead of inward, that says, no, this is where meaning and significance is. It's not here, it's out there. That's great, except that children and spouses and other sinful human beings will ultimately disappoint, right? So it's teaching two lessons.
That's true.
So this is why people need a real solid rock.
The other highlight of the weekend was Deadpool came out last weekend. 132.4 million over 3 days. That was the earliest movie to have ever opened with over 100 million in almost a month.
Can I make a confession?
Yes.
I have no idea what Deadpool is. Can you explain this to me?
Okay.
And Deadpool, why this is a big news?
Okay, so the reason this is news is because this is the first Marvel comic book movie, superhero movie, to be one rated R.
Ah.
And two, it's done better than all the other ones. So everybody, what's happened is, in case you haven't been watching the kerfluffle, it's not a clean movie. I mean, this is a hard R. It's not as hard as, say, Kingsman Secret Service, which I also enjoyed. But it is a very hard R. And what everybody's whining about, and I'm going to say whining because, guys, there's been worse movies to come out over time, is that it's a Marvel movie and they're sending the wrong message by making an R-rated movie. So parents are taking their kids and all this stuff, and there's tons of violence and lots of language and nudity and blah, blah, blah.
It's been going on forever.
And guess what? Cinemax and HBO and stuff you can find on
your
Netflix
TV dial
or Amazon have been doing worse stuff for years, so deal with it. But I think the one comment that caught my eye, James Gunn, director of Guardians of Galaxy, said over Facebook, choice quote, we'll put this link, all the information we're talking about is going to be in the show notes, links, comments, everything. Here's what James Gunn had to say about it. So over the next few months, if you pay attention to the trades, meaning Hollywood buy, sell, movies and stuff, you'll see Hollywood misunderstanding the lesson they should be learning from Deadpool. They'll be greenlighting films like Deadpool, but by that they won't mean good and original, but a raunchy superhero film. It breaks the fourth wall, or etc. They'll treat you like you're stupid, which is the one thing Deadpool didn't do, which is also what Guardians of the Galaxy did so well. It was original, it was fresh, and it was creative. So Hollywood's going to take away... Let's be raunchy. That's what sells. Instead of taking risk... This movie was in production for almost 10 years.
Wow.
It's been because it was such a stretch and such a risk for the studios, they didn't want to bank on it, but...
Given those numbers that you shared earlier, it sounds like it paid off.
Yeah, it paid off. Quick note, there is one actually Christian movie, I guess, faith-based movie coming out that I am interested in seeing. I don't know if you guys have seen the previews for this. Risen.
Joseph Fiennes, right?
Joseph Fiennes, the manhunt version of Jesus' resurrection. Evidently, there's some political...
It's a really cool concept.
It's a great concept, and so I'm actually kind of looking forward to seeing it.
So this is the Roman centurion tasked with find the body, right?
Oh, crap. Hmm. The body's gone missing.
I love it.
It's kind of a detective story, and there's some Roman political intrigue. It's a great take on it.
I really hope that the movie's well done. I mean, obviously Joseph Fiennes is legit, a lot of faith-based movies tend to lack a lot of production values.
The opening scene in the trailer is Fiennes stabbing someone with a sword. So I was like, we're making progress.
that's in a Christian movie.
Okay. All right, those are our quick takes for today. Guys, we're going to get to our deep topics now. We've decided we're about a half hour per topic show, so we've got three of them today. Or 20 minutes, I guess. Antonin Scalia, Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court, died unexpectedly this past Saturday. His vacancy on the High Court ignited a firestorm of controversy in an already contentious election year. His death raises the possibility of his seat being replaced by a president diametrically opposed to his judicial philosophy. possibly altering the balance of the court for an entire generation. Right now, up until then, it's been a pretty much a 4-4 split, right, Brian?
Well, it's pretty balanced.
With a couple guys that kind of waffle.
You've got four conservatives, four liberals, and one guy who it depends on how he feels when he wakes up in the morning.
Right. Well, let's talk about two things, okay? First, what are your overall thoughts about Justice Scalia and his death? What made his judicial philosophy unique, you know? What do you make of the President Obama not attending the funeral? Things like that. Just kind of the overall
picture.
The picture.
It was a punch. It was a big punch to the gut when I found out that he had died. You know, I think everybody who shares sort of my worldview felt a great loss in his death, not just because it's sad when someone dies, but because his vacancy on the court is of utmost consequence. He's really been an anchor on the right side of the court. We can talk about swing Justice Kennedy and why he's such a swing justice. I mean, I think that the history surrounding Justice Kennedy is very relevant now. But my first reaction was, this is terrible news. And I wanted to despair a little bit about the future of the court, but as Christians, I don't think despair is a good look for us. So yeah. I try to be hopeful about it. But, you know, I don't think the reaction from Christians should be to be fearful about the future. God is still in control. I don't think that Justice Scalia would be happy that the country, you know, the death of one person affects the country so much, because he was always talking about the role of the court and how he didn't think that nine justices should be so important and that their rulings should have so much to bear on our laws, that really the role of the court should be interpreting and ruling about things that are within their scope and not outside of their scope. Mm-hmm. And I'd say another facet to his legacy is that he was an originalist. You know, he believed in reading the Constitution as the authors of the Constitution intended for it to be read. And he was the diametric opposition to the idea of a living Constitution, or a Constitution that morphs and changes over time. So he was an excellent conservative and also a great writer. His opinions are fun to read. Even if you're not a lawyer, I suggest you go find a good recent dissent that Scalia has written and enjoy it, because it's enjoyable reading. And so I have obviously enormous respect for Justice Scalia. And I started thinking of all the other days I've experienced as a young conservative. You know, there was Obama's first election. There was the passage of Obamacare, the upholding of Obamacare, Obama's reelection. I mean, there's been a lot of nights where I've sat thinking, this is it. This is, you know, it's a republic. A republic, if you can keep it. I'm not sure if we can keep it. And Justice Scalia's death will be up there on my list of nights that I remember thinking, man, it's a bad day for conservatives.
It was a bad day. Justice Scalia's death was not just a vacancy on the court. It is a gaping hole in the court because he was a giant of a legal scholar, a giant of a man. His influence on the court and on judicial philosophy in America really can't be overstated. He will be remembered, regardless of whether people agree with him or not. He will be remembered as one of the greatest American jurists in the history of our republic. I was 16 years old in 1992. I was on a family road trip, actually, ironically, driving through Pennsylvania when the Supreme Court came out with its ruling, Planned Parenthood versus Casey, which is a Pennsylvania case. That was a case in which the Supreme Court had the full opportunity to reverse Roe versus Wade and overturn that terrible 1973 decision. Justice Kennedy changed his mind during the course of the proceedings, and they did not strike down Roe versus Wade. I was 16, and I believe it was the Philadelphia Inquirer published a lengthy excerpt of Justice Scalia's dissent in Planned Parenthood versus Casey. I sat in the back of the car and I read it, and this was the first time I had ever become acquainted with Justice Scalia. I was hooked. I was blown away. I wanted to be a lawyer from that time forward. I couldn't believe how beautifully clear it was, how well written it was, and how devastating it was. He did that for 30 years on the court. Every time he wrote a dissent, it was like that. People would get Supreme Court decisions and flip to the page where Scalia's dissent is, right? Because that's where the real meat is. My appreciation, I can't overstate my appreciation for him. I too was really gut punched when I heard that he had passed away. It is a tremendous loss. But to your point, Hadley, about despair. 30 years ago, when Justice Scalia was affirmed as an associate justice, and by the way, that was 98-0 in the Senate approving him to the High Court. Man, have times changed.
Yeah.
Wow.
30 years ago, the concept of originalism was a parochial, backwater, archaic philosophy that no law school anywhere gave any time to. They didn't care about it. 30 years after, 30 years on the court, Justice Scalia, not single-handedly, but he was a major force in making originalism, and he actually didn't like that term. He was a textualist, which is actually more narrow than an originalist. He has made originalism, helped make originalism into an extremely viable movement in the judicial field. The Federalist Society didn't exist. ADF didn't exist. There were all sorts of organizations. He has helped galvanize an entire judicial movement in this country that didn't exist when he got on the court. So don't despair. He is leaving an incredible legacy, and there are thousands of young lawyers and judges and clerks who have learned from him and learned at his feet. And we will, I believe, win this battle. We have a movement, and we're not going to be stopped. Justice Scalia believed that a textual document says certain things and doesn't say other things. And that is the fundamental role of a judge. What does it say? Not what do I wish it said? What do I want it to say? He famously would say things like, there's no such thing as a moderate reading of a document. What is a moderate reading of a document?
That would be jiggery pokery or pure applesauce.
Yeah, pure applesauce. There's no moderate reading. So when people say we need a moderate justice, he says that exposes what's really going on. You want a judge to be a policymaker. You want the judge to have the right opinions about what the outcomes should be. That is not what judging is about. He was a stalwart. He has created a movement. And this is not a time for despair. This really is a time for celebration of his legacy and what he achieved. And it is a time to gird up our loins and continue the fight, continue the battle. That is what he would want.
Speaking of girding up loins, guys, what are some of the politics surrounding replacing him? I mean, we're going to gird up and go.
But I think some Republicans need to gird up their loins.
You got some people saying, well, the GOP should block, the GOP should not block, that we should wait until Trump gets elected or something.
Oh Lord.
God forbid.
Hillary. I have a really simple bit of advice for a Republican United States Senator. This is really going to be complicated, okay? I want you to really follow me. When people start saying, oh, but we need to be reasonable, and we need to, have hearings for the nominee, and we need to have a vote on the nominee, and we can't deprive the president of his constitutional authority to nominate someone, and when the media puts all kinds of pressure on you and says, aren't you being unreasonable? Okay, guys, this is really complicated. Really complicated. No. The answer is no. All of the whining is so disingenuous. Anybody with any semblance of objectivity knows that if the shoe were on the other foot, and by the way, it has been on the other foot in Democrat-led Senates by Harry Reid, where they would just simply say, no, we're not holding hearings on judicial nominees. you know what, guys? You lost the Senate. You don't like it. Go win the Senate back. But right now, the Senate has no constitutional obligation to take up a Supreme Court nomination. And so the answer is no. And you know what? Just you're going to get attacked. Big deal. The answer is no.
Hadley.
I think different senators have to take different approaches. And I know Brian made it very clear that this is not complicated. But let me tell you, I think behind the scenes, that's good advice, Brian. Behind the scenes, that's great advice. But if I were a senator up for re-election this in a purple place that AMA took in 2012, I think publicly, and this is why people hate politics, but play along.
All right.
I would say, let's wait and see who President Obama nominates, and let's consider the nominee. Yeah, behind the scenes, I'm thinking,
no.
But I don't know that it benefits every senator to come out as Mitch McConnell did and say, doesn't matter who he nominates, we're going to block his nomination. I agree with everything else Brian said, but I think that the politics of it, if you hear your senator saying something like, let's consider who the person is, it may not be that they're actually considering affirming a nomination from the president. But that may be something that they feel like they have to say, or that they're being advised to say.
That's well put, Hadley. I'll concur with you on that. It makes the trouble you run into is that taking a political approach like that certainly makes your base very nervous. All right, so that's the downside. I mean, when you intentionally go out and look wobbly. You look wobbly to everybody, including your core constituency. That's a problem. I just want to point out, why am I so adamant about this? This is not an ordinary vacancy. This is, number one, you have a lame duck president. We have an election in November, so the circumstances are very significant. But this is what's significant. We are talking about replacing the anchor of the conservative side of the court. We're talking about replacing one of the greatest jurists in the history of this country. And I'm sorry, when I'm confronted with the possibility that we're going to replace Justice Scalia with another Sonia Sotomayor or Elena Kagan, again, not complicated. No. No.
Yeah, I think the Democrats are going to play politics on this just as much as the Republicans are.
Right.
You know, I think the parties, in terms of those so-called moderate or independent voters out there, I think the parties can fight to a draw with their talking points here. Because I've been, first of all, I was very upset to see a few liberal friends of mine celebrating the death of Justice Scalia, which I think has no place in a decent society. He's a human and a fellow American, as well as a conservative, mm-hmm. but that's the place our discourse has reached, unfortunately. And then I saw a columnist for CNN, someone that is liberal, but I like to read his columns. I have some respect for his point of view, even if I disagree with it. I saw him tweet something like, the Republicans say that the people need a voice in Scalia's replacement. Well, what about President Obama? He's the voice of the people, and he's been elected twice. And I thought to myself, well, you know, my senator is my voice, too. My Republican senator is my voice, too. And if you don't, you know, agree, look back at the history, recent history even, Senator Schumer and Senator Barack Obama.
That's right.
Who both opposed fiercely nominations to the court from Bush 43. I mean, this is not rocket science. If you're truly an independent, if you're truly a moderate, if you truly take both parties and you look at their, you know, their honesties and their dishonesties, their pros and their cons, you know that if the tables were turned, they'd be using the exact opposite talking points here.
Right.
So that's exactly what's happened. And I mentioned Justice Kennedy, and just to fill in our listeners, you know, the reason Justice Kennedy is not a strong conservative is because he wasn't President Reagan's first choice.
That's right. And this all goes back to who the first choice was.
Right. And James Taranto, who writes for the Wall Street Journal, cleverly titled his thoughts on this Bork to the Future.
Yeah.
Which that was a good title. Because there was a nomination for Robert Bork to the Supreme Court. This was in 1987. And Democrats totally executed character assassination against this man and refused to nominate him to the Supreme Court. So he was rejected in 1987. And Democrats now are pointing to Justice Kennedy. Oh, look, here's someone who was confirmed in an election year. Right. But he was, I think, the third choice that President Reagan made for an appointment. That's why he's such a moderate. That's why he's not a reliable conservative vote on the court, is because President Reagan nominated someone who would have been a reliable conservative voice, but the Democrats blocked this person. So this is not unprecedented or uncharted waters that a judicial nomination, even a Supreme Court nomination, would be blocked by members of the other party based on grounds that have nothing to do with qualifications. I mean, Democrats now are pretending like, oh, the Senate should give consent unless there's something wrong with the person's qualifications. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. Even Senator Obama said, I believe that Justice Alito is qualified. I believe that Justice Roberts is qualified, but I'm voting against them anyway.
Yeah, he filibustered Sam Alito. So
exactly.
This is what's good for the goose is good for the gander here. And I think to your last point, Hadley, it bears repeating that it is the left in this country that has made ideology one of the qualifications. Okay? If everybody had Justice Scalia's view of what lawyering is and what judging is, that is, we're just simply interpreting this text over against this other text here and seeing if they're reconcilable or not. If that was it, you could pass people 98-0 like Scalia was, because that's the job. And you know what? What you need in that case is a good lawyer. But because the living Constitution left wants judges to be policymakers and to shape and morph and craft the Constitution in a direction they think beneficial for society, now your ideology becomes the qualification. And that's what Scalia hated. He raged against it. He said it is completely wrong. Because you know what? Supreme Court justices have no special competence to be policymakers. And that is a creation of the left. And so I think it's perfectly fair for a Republican Senate to say, if that's what you guys are going to make judging, we are going to hold accountable your nominee for what they believe, what their ideology is. And we're not going to get it. We're not going to get a nominee from Barack Obama that isn't hard leftist. That's just
right.
The
well,
way
that
it is.
To that point, I wanted to add, you know, I was curious what Obama's next move would be, because. And he's made it clear that he's going to nominate someone who is not a moderate. You know, he's made it clear that he's not going to play that game. But initially I thought, you know, if he's smart, maybe he does choose someone who is a Republican in name only, someone who's been appointed by a Republican to a lower federal bench, someone who has some, you know, mixed point of views or mixed record on some of the issues, just to put greater political pressure on Republican senators to affirm this person. Mm-hmm. And I also thought, another very cynical thought I have, is that the president may use as part of his selection criteria the color of someone's skin,
right,
or their sex. And then the election issue becomes about, not only are these Republicans obstructionists, but they're racist and they're sexist too. And so I'm afraid that that's the game that he wants to play. We'll wait and see who he nominates, but he says he's not interested in nominating a moderate. And my last point on this whole issue is that although I would support my Republican senator voting against any nomination before Obama leaves office, it does make me sad. It makes me sad that, you know, all these examples we've been pointing out of just how bifurcated and antagonistic our political parties have become, this is another step in that direction. I don't think that that changes anything. I think if we put the wool over our eyes and pretend like, oh, let's play nice while the Democrats play dirty, no, that doesn't work. Doesn't mm-hmm. work. But it mm-hmm. does make me a little bit sad. I mourn a little bit for the division in our country. I mourn a lot, actually.
I do too. But this is a massive tipping point. This, look, people talk about what hills do you die on in politics.
This is a hill.
this isn't a hill. This is Everest. This is a mountain, right? Because this will shape the direction of our jurisprudence in our country for another 30 or 40 years. And this we cannot afford to give away.
Do you think like Ginsburg would last 30 or 40 years?
Oh, well, you're presuming that Ginsburg would be replaced by a Republican.
Yeah, I am.
At this point,
I'm being hopeful.
That's totally up in the air.
Well, I am going to be hopeful.
You can't count on that.
Well, see, what happens is typically if you're an ideological justice, that was appointed by a Democrat. You wait for a Democrat president to be elected close to when you want to retire or leave the court. Right. And that's why there's been a lot of pressure on Ginsburg to leave during Obama's two terms, you know. But she's hoping that either the next president will be a Democrat or she can last until there's another Democrat in the White House, right? That's always the game that they play. And so what's happened here is a conservative justice has died, leaving a vacancy while a very liberal Democrat is in the White House. And that's not typically what we see in these days, where it's sort of, oh, it's just up to chance who leaves and who dies at what time. It's really not. It's a very calculated decision most of the time.
Unless you die.
Right. But the balance of the court is what it is, unless you have some strange circumstance like this one that could potentially change the balance of the court. And let's face it, it's a reality that enough Republican senators join with Democrats to confirm someone. That could happen.
Those poor Republicans just can't catch a break, can they?
Nope.
Nope. Can I go back to, look, guys, this isn't complicated. No.
What's Brian's answer? No.
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 Charles Schumer is nobody on the other side of the aisle is acting in anything remotely resembling good faith, okay? It's not good faith.
Right. We've heard your opinion. We've heard your opinion.
No!
Oh, man. We're going to take a little break, do something fun, and come back and talk about a little bit of Apple, a little bit of national security, and a little bit of fun. But first, guys, first. All right, Nerd versus Nerd, the segment of the show where we pit intellect via intellect, and it's all culturally based. We don't make up words. Our producer, Remley, finds them on the internet. They are actual internet terms, and we see who can come up with either A, the most witty answer, or B, the actual answer. So,
any idea who's winning this game?
Hadley's ahead by two.
That's not possible. Drake
there
face.
Have been so many...
Drake face was the greatest ever, and I didn't get a point for Drake face.
I run the game. I make up the score. All right. Today's today's word.
I today's... think he's in the tank for you, Hadley. That's what
Thanks,
I think.
Thanks, Jay. I like your rules.
She's cuter. She's pregnant, and she has to do this show for remote. We got to cut her a break.
All right, fine.
Says me. All right. Today's word. Aureolization. Of course, everybody on the live stream right now is like calling out their favorites.
No, yeah, I'm okay, not going to look right. at the live stream.
I got an idea.
Don't look
I
at the live stream.
No, I mean, some of them are going, go Brian, go Team Hadley, go. You guys have like cheerleaders.
We have fans.
I love it.
All right, I intentionally don't look at the live stream during games because I don't want to take clues or hints from.
Yeah, so I'm not looking at.
I'm just
not
telling you. People. You guys both have cheers.
I want to know how to spell it. Can you spell that for me?
Oriole, like the Baltimore Orioles,
like
but with an E instead of an I, like the bird. Aureolization,
oh, okay.
Like a realization.
I got a guess.
Okay.
I got a guess.
All right.
I got a guess, but this is not politically correct.
That's okay. I think I'm going to guess the same thing as you, so.
Okay. Well, let me go first.
Go for it.
So I've heard this term used in a derogatory way before about a black person who acts white. They call that person an Oreo.
Black on the outside, white on the inside.
Right.
What is white on the outside, black on the inside?
Eminem.
Because that's what I got. That's what I got called a little bit in my early days playing for
okay,
gospel and hip-hop
groups.
Okay, I
don't think you've ever been called that by a black person, but.
Oh, ask my buddies at Moody.
Okay.
Okay. So what is Aureolization?
Where is Moody?
Chicago. Downtown Chicago.
There's a lot of black people there.
Okay. All right. Well, I just have never known Jay to be that black. But,
he used to play in a hip-hop band.
I used to be the only white guy in hip-hop and gospel groups. Yeah. And did all my work
this
on the
just
south
a side.
Side
of Jay that
out.
I've never seen.
It's a legit
I've never
sign.
Seen Jay with, you know, he wears flat bills sometimes, but I don't really imagine a lot of
I got married. what I did is I got married and she made me get rid of all my urban clothes, you know, typically a little bit baggier and
yeah.
But I never was like a gangbanger, but you know, I was.
You were playing in gospel groups in black churches.
We were doing
all
black
over
churches
the place,
all over Southside Chicago.
You sort of were.
It was awesome.
You're like the white Lecrae. Okay.
Yeah, he was.
I toured. I did some state touring in New Mexico with a local gospel artist. We did a bunch of big shows. We just toured all around the state, and it was awesome.
Yeah. For listeners who don't know, Jay is an excellent bass guitarist.
But I had no skills, and I still don't have. Like I couldn't keep up with them because they play the same song, but it'd be a different key every single time. And then
you're selling yourself short. Jay's a pretty good bassist.
And then they would just change. They would just say, like, we're going to keep going on this riff. Oh, okay, cool. I can keep up. And it was tough. But the drummer was amazing to play with.
Okay. He was phenomenal. Anyway, Hadley, aureolization.
Okay. So by extension, I think aureolization might be a term used to describe like the gentrification of something or the changing of a white person or black person or a black community into something that is more white in whatever way people want to define that.
Okay. Aureolization, Brian.
Well, see, this is tough because, I mean, I think Hadley's exactly right. I mean, it has something.
Was that going to be your guess too originally, or have
yes,
I convinced
mine
you?
Was going to be, okay. No, mine was going to be the same thing, but yours was actually, you kind of hedged a lot. I mean, it can be the making white of an individual or a community and gentrification. I was like, can we be more specific?
No.
You guys.
Aureolization.
I don't have to be.
I'm going to say have the same answer, only I'm going to make it way more specific. And it is best exemplified by The Cosby Show.
Huh.
A black family. Living the upper middle class, kind of sort of a white lifestyle. Now, that's not politically correct, but that's what I think the term means.
That you guys are so far from what it means. It's just unbelievable. But it makes sense given your political bents.
Listen,
no, I don't think my politics have nothing to do with this. I just want to make that very clear. Growing up, I heard the term Oreo sometimes.
No, the world you guys
nothing
inhabit.
To do with the way that I view
the way you
white
think.
Or black people.
I blame social justice warriors.
Okay, guys, guys, you're overthinking this one in a major way. And I want to apologize now for potentially giving Hadley any pregnancy cravings. It's actually aureolization is the realization that Oreos are still in your kitchen.
Oh, realization.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The realization that Oreos
are still
in
your kitchen.
Man, dude.
I'm not even a big fan of Oreos.
Oh, I love it. Yeah, but so. I love Oreos. I have a craving.
How can you not be a fan of Oreos? That's like, that stuff is like one of the greatest things ever produced. Wow.
That's okay.
I don't really have a bad sweet tooth. I like, you know, if you give me a bag of Goldfish, I'm set.
Well, you are in trouble because that is a child's favorite snack, a
yes,
Goldfish. So
totally.
You can just have them in the house all the time.
Yeah. Me and my baby are just going to be eating Goldfish,
you'd be
all,
goldfish
the
okay. all the time.
They sell the big boxes at Costco, you know, now. Big bags of Goldfish that comes in very handy.
We get those, yes. Mm-hmm. They're delicious. Guys, the Apple Corporation made huge headlines this week.
We're not talking about Donald Trump right now.
A pastor once. No, I still do. Our pastor, Brian. He doesn't pronounce his H's.
Right.
Huge.
Mm-hmm.
Yevin.
Human.
I don't get it. Mm-hmm. The Apple Corporation made huge headlines this week by releasing a letter from CEO Tim Cook explaining why Apple is resisting helping the FBI in their investigation of a San Bernardino terrorist. He says essentially that the FBI is requesting that Apple purposely create a backdoor entry into their encryption technology. If they do so, he argues, then it can and will be done again. The know-how will exist, putting all of Apple's users at risk. On the other hand, critics of Apple are skeptical that there is no solution to crack this one single iPhone without putting the entire realm of personal privacy in peril. Guys, this seems like a really tough one. Mm-hmm. We, you know, like the three of us are probably somewhat concerned. I've met people who are completely not concerned with their own personal privacy. Other people are. But it's kind of a slippery slope. The, you know, Apple's slippery slope argument seems kind of reasonable here. The government is asking them to positively create something that doesn't exist to make a product, essentially. But can the government do that?
That's a really good question.
Would we trust the government with that? What are the competing interests here, if anything?
Man.
Is the government really asking Apple, or
the government is
Apple?
Really asking?
Ordering,
they're ordering actually, but Apple's
because I think that, you know, when we have like Senator Sanders running for president, and the liberal left likes to say things like, "We're just asking wealthy Americans to pay more in taxes."
Right. No.
I think we need to push back on that.
This asking is that's a euphemism. They're not asking.
Yeah.
They're being told to do it. What? It's a tough. This is a tough nut to crack.
You've got legitimate concerns on both sides. You've got national security. We want to do everything we can to prevent terrorism. And then you've got...
A terrorist had one of these, an iPhone, with all sorts of maybe very important stuff on it that can lead to...
So much nuance, though,
I know.
In this case. He didn't really have the phone. You know, it belonged to his employer. So...
It's
there's another issue.
There's so many levels here.
So many levels.
Like,
so many levels of encryption technology.
I guess I just wonder the legal... I mean, I've been trying to think through my head of analogies. It would be sort of like a company who made a safe. And their safe was unbreakable. It'd be like, you know, and then it was captured by law enforcement authorities because it belonged to a thief, right? And the thief's the goods are in a safe, and the authorities can't crack it. Is it unreasonable for them to go to the maker of the safe and say, you need to help us crack this safe? And would it be for the company to go, no way, because if you tell us to figure out a way to crack our own safe, then you've destroyed our business, and we can't do this anymore. I mean, is that an analogy that works?
I think...
No.
Why not?
I don't think so.
Why not?
Well, because not everybody owns a physical safe like that. How many people have one of these, you know? Like, almost every person in our country. So it's a little bit different when it's digital stuff. And the primary purpose of a safe is to keep things locked away. The primary purpose of an iPhone is not to keep things locked away. That is one of the functions...
But
it's a multifunctional object. I think it's hard to come up with an analogy for this specific case because there's really not anything that's just like an iPhone.
I think there's...
This is not a multifunctional device. I have discovered recently in my home that this device is good for one thing. Scrolling through pictures of puppies. Okay. So my 2-year-old constantly is begging me to look at puppies. And it's so sweet. It's so infuriating and irritating and sweet at the same time. She has developed the perfect look she gives me. She walks up to me and she tilts her head and she smiles and she goes, "Puppies." And I can't resist. So that's all my phone is used for, is to scroll through puppies. Sorry for that little sidetrack.
I can't help but think that there's a little bit at play here of, you know, I mean, of kind of ruining it for everybody else. On the one hand, I can kind of see I don't think there's anything necessarily wrong with the government coming and asking Apple to help them hack this phone. He was convicted. It was his phone. It was, like, verifiable.
He wasn't convicted. He was shot.
It wasn't, I mean, it was verifiable that he was a terrorist. And they're asking to get into this one phone. But if Apple does that, then Apple says, oh, you know, we're not a zero encryption technology company like we say we are. Like, only you have access to your data, not us. So I can see some liability there, like, on Apple. Because if Apple has access to, you know, so anyway, that's the new trend where it's going. It's all zero encryption now, where only you have access and the manufacturer can't get into it. Right. Google can't get into your Android. Apple can't get into your iPhone. Only you can get into it. But if they build a back door, then that makes it more accessible for hackers.
Yeah.
And they already have it. They already do a really dang good job. You don't need to, like, you know, tell them obvious back doors here. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. Like, on the one hand, I want them to, like, really rail on this guy. But on the other hand, it's like, I don't want to... From Apple's perspective, if they do this for him, what is going to prevent them from doing it for everybody else? And then
I just see the competing interests here as really difficult. Okay, on the one hand, we really pride ourselves in our country of having our right of privacy, right? I mean, it's enshrined in our Fourth Amendment. Mm-hmm. Government can't come peeking into your business. without legit reason and without a warrant. And, you know, so we really do value this sort of privacy. We now have this technology that, I mean, seriously, are you telling the FBI can't break into this thing? Actually, they could. I don't have a passcode set right now. But if I had a passcode, are you telling me that the federal authorities cannot break into this?
Real life is not television.
That is incredible to me. On the other hand,
we put a man on the moon and we can't crack the iPhone. Right?
Well, encryption's amazing. But on the other hand, I mean, as a Christian, I go, look, I mean, what's the fundamental basic role of the civil government? It is crime and punishment. It is protecting the populace. It is avenging the victim and bringing vengeance on the wrongdoer. That's what Paul tells us in Romans 13. So that's the source of my conflict. To me, we all too easily in our country, because of our history of personal freedom, we like to kind of revert to our default is always suspicion of the government, right? Which is a healthy thing in many ways. That's a healthy thing, suspicion of government power. On the other hand, I turn around and say, they're asking to do something that is completely in line with their God-ordained job. The God-ordained job is we got to find out who this guy's accomplices are and prevent them from carrying out another attack. So it's not an illegitimate use of government. So that's why I'm so conflicted. We have two things going on.
Is that
here.
The same question as asking them to build back doors for them into future devices?
See, that's the thing. And you're asking a company to actually, as Tim Cook says, you're asking us to create something that doesn't exist. And we don't have an obligation to do that. That's a strong argument to me. But I'm conflicted because I think, you know, I think on these sorts of issues, national security issues, crime and punishment issues, I think that the government is deserving of a lot of benefit of the doubt and a lot of leeway for the simple reason that this is a totally legitimate exercise of their authority. Hmm. So I don't know, Hadley, what do you think?
I also see the competing interests and the competing values at play here, and I think so much of the competition depends on the context. As one of my friends pointed out, imagine if this phone belonged to one of the guys who flew into the World Trade Center, and it was September 12th, 2001, and we were having this debate about whether or not Apple was obligated to help us into that person's phone, and what information we might get, because it's not just about punishment, it's about future protection for
exactly,
us
right.
as citizens from potential threats and from terrorists who use this technology potentially to communicate about harming us. And so I think right now we have the benefit of, you know, I don't live in San Bernardino. One of the people killed was not one of my family members. You know, I see it as a heinous event. But it's also not got the same level of urgency surrounding it that something like 9/11 had. And I think the context and the specifics of this situation, the circumstances surrounding it, are also part of what's driving, you know, how we balance these competing interests. Because I think it is good to have a suspicion of the government. Honestly, the first thing I thought of when this Apple story came up was the scene in Bridge of Spies, the movie with Tom Hanks.
Mm. I just bought it. Down. Haven't seen it yet.
Haven't seen it yet either.
Okay, well, there's one scene. This is not a spoiler. There's one scene where a government official is following Tom Hanks. And Tom Hanks, you know, is not comfortable being followed. So he sits down with the guy and they talk. And the guy, I'm not sure if he's from the FBI or the CIA, but he says, look, this client of yours is a spy. And if he tells you anything that is pertinent to national security, you need to come tell me. And Tom Hanks says, you're asking me to violate client privilege. You know, you're asking me to divulge secrets that might change the case for my client, whom I have a sacred duty as an attorney of law to do what's right in the best interest of my client. And so I thought, well, there is an interesting moral dilemma, because of course, Tom Hanks, the character he plays, is an American citizen. He cares about the safety and security of the United States. This is during Cold War times. This is actually during the conflict Yeah, Cold War, surrounding the Soviets and the Americans. Is a Soviet spy that he's supposed to be defending in court, because we believe that every person should have counsel in a court of law. And so he's trying to follow the letter of the law and be a good lawyer and be true to that value. But he's also, you know, I'm sure he feels in some way he has to have felt some obligation to help his country. You know, he just thought, what kind of country are we defending if we don't stay true to our own values? And so I think that's similar to the dilemma that we saw in Bridge of Spies, the movie, but I think the context really matters in terms of how we feel about it and how we respond at this point.
You know, Dave, I'd be interested in your take on this, Brian, given your comments, your biblical comments. And it falls kind of in line with what you were just saying. David McGinnis on our live stream said, you know, when it comes to national security, I believe we have to view ourselves as a citizen of the country, not as an individual entity.
Right.
Is that, I mean, I guess you could go both ways with that too. You could say, well, there'd be too much overreach there by the government. At the same time, where's the line? You know, where's the line saying, okay, well, that's too much and that isn't?
I don't know. That's why, you know, that's why I'm saying, I mean, my whole thing on this segment is, guys, I don't know what to think. I mean, I think there's got to be a third way here. There's got to be a third way. I just am skeptical that something cannot be worked out here to achieve the interests of both the Apple Corporation, the, you know, safety and security of people's privacy, and law enforcement. I just think there has to be a way. You know, it's because it's kind of a mess right now. And I don't know what the answer to the question is. I just see the competing interests, and I see the question is, of course, I think as Hadley was just bringing up, is how do you prioritize your allegiances, right? When you have competing allegiances and competing, you know, principles. In this case, Apple has a, you know, an obligation to help law enforcement, but they feel like, no, we also have a duty to our customers and to our product. Those are in conflict. We have, on the other hand, the government has a duty to respect privacy and to, you know, not have access to everybody's private information, and yet a duty to get into this phone, right? It's all these competing things, and I think it is, and there's bright minds hopefully working on it. I do have to say this. I didn't like the letter from Tim Cook. It felt to me like kind of grandstanding and kind of I'm going to argue my case in the court of public opinion. This is a live court case that's going on. He just had a ruling against him that Apple's going to appeal. And instead of simply going through the appellate process, arguing your case in the appellate court, Tim Cook decided, I'm going to get all of the legions of my Uber fans all over social media having an outcry about what the government is doing. I felt like that was kind of an end around the legal process, and it felt like grandstanding to me.
Hadley, I think you have a thought.
Yeah, I mean, it was an advertisement is what that letter was. Because advertising today, if you watch a lot of the Super Bowl commercials or any ad, I mean, maybe not any ad, but a lot of ads, and a lot of the smartest ads today are not about products. They're not following the traditional mold of, hey, you've got a problem. We can fix it with our product. Because that used to be the, you know, create cognitive dissonance and resolve it by offering your product. That used to be the model for commercials and advertisements for products and ideas everywhere. But now it's all about associating your brand with some higher ideals, some social responsibility, some value that you think will resonate with a lot of people, so that when they go buy your product, they feel good about buying your product. Like, oh yeah, I have an Apple phone, so I'm associated with Tim Cook and everything he said in that letter, and sticking it to the man and standing up for individual liberties, and that's how I can feel good about buying Apple products. And that's the way a lot of companies are doing their advertising now. It's about
brilliant.
Here's what we stand for. And if you want to stand for that too, you'll come buy our product.
Our social cause, right? And the social cause here is your personal, you know, your Fourth Amendment liberties, right?
I have a cheap Chinese phone, and they probably put some bad, they're probably spying on the communication.
You're already hacked.
I'm hacked.
So what Jay stands for is child labor.
Yeah, Jay stands for.
Oh, come on. It's a great phone. But I do use secure messaging and secure email and other secure devices. So, but I don't know. They probably can read that.
So it sounds like, Hadley, you were actually kind of agreeing with me, but going even further. I was like, this is sort of a grandstanding end around the legal process to litigate this in the court of public opinion. You're actually saying, no, it's actually more cynical than that. This is just simply advertising.
Well, I don't mean to be cynical. I mean to be realistic. I haven't read the letter, but I saw the way it was virally passed around Facebook and some of the things that my friends had to say about it. And I thought, you're carrying water for them. You're just passing around their latest ad. And that's the way that a lot of ads have gone viral, is that they're about something else, some cause or some, you know,
social justice cause.
Right. And people pass it around. They're like, hey, I love this commercial because of what it says about this value that I share. And they're actually passing around an ad for a product. It's brilliant.
The anti-corporation people are passing around the corporation's.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
Wow.
Oh, man.
Guys, interesting discussion.
That's a good discussion.
I don't have any answers. I certainly hope they can come up with some answers.
I like the Christian perspective you brought to the table too. That was insightful. When we come back, Trump versus Pope madness. But first, little game of spy versus spy in honor of all the government Apple madness
and Bridge of Spies.
Bridge of Spies. Okay, so how this game works, there is no winners and no losers. This is purely opinion.
Good.
Purely opinion. Okay, guys, we're going to ask you, I'm going to, Mortal Kombat style, we're going to pit two spies. They could be literature or film or what have you, against each other. And you need to tell me who you think would win and why.
Ooh, fun. Okay.
Man, I got a little tickle in my throat. All right. First up, Jack Ryan from Tom Clancy's Hunt for Red October, Patriot Games, Clear and Present Danger, versus Maxwell Smart and Agent 99 from Get Smart. Who would win and why?
I don't even know that second guy, so that's a problem.
I haven't seen Get Smart.
Jeez, yeah. Okay, moving on. I've got a whole bunch to choose
from. But Jack Ryan wins because he has a PhD in history. Ha!
The name of this game is secretly reveal how secret nerdy... Reveal. Brian and Hadley actually are.
I kind of find a little bit of fun in, like, you know, these guys have weaknesses, believe it or not. They, you know.
Jack Ryan does have a PhD in history.
Nancy Drew versus the Hardy Boys.
Ooh. Nancy Drew every time.
Why? The Hardy Boys are good.
Yeah, they're good. I think that there's some value to working alone if you're a spy.
Okay.
And Nancy Drew is very clever. She's,
I have a question.
She's a lady.
I have a question.
This is where Brian doesn't have answers and he like takes us off topic.
No, I'm not going. No, this isn't off topic. I want to know what these spies are competing about. Are they?
They're just fighting, Mortal Kombat style. Yeah.
No,
just
Hardy Boys win. Whatever tools they're boys, they have. They're boys. They're stronger than Nancy, and there's two of them.
I thought that this was a sleuthing competition. Like
it is sleuthing. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. However,
it can be sleuthing or beating the crap out of each other.
Yeah, intellectual or otherwise. Okay, Severus, and you guys online can have your own debates on the thing. Severus Snape versus Nick Fury.
Severus.
I honestly don't know anything about these characters.
Oh my goodness. Oh wow, I can't believe we just exposed that.
Wow.
Who's Nick Fury?
Nick Fury, the Avengers, the guy with the eye patch.
Look, Severus Snape is the greatest double agent in the history of literature. And
okay. I have this horrible urge to call. I'm not gonna say it.
Okay, but seriously, Snape beats everybody. I mean, you can match him up with anybody on any of these lists, and he's gonna be victorious. He is the greatest double agent in the history of literature. So,
I haven't read or seen any of that witchcraft stuff.
Oh my
goodness,
you're just from Carolina. You guys don't read all that stuff with spells and spooks.
I was going to say I wanted to
That's called witchcraft.
It's one of the greatest series of novels written
it is amazing.
100 years.
It is
so
amazing.
You really
I'm really itching to get back into that. I wanted to make a Samuel L. Jackson it. Lawrence Fishburne joke, but I wasn't going.
I just finished it out loud to my kids just a few months ago.
Which voice was the one where you like hurt your throat every time you talked like it?
Well, that'd be Voldemort.
Voldemort.
Voldemort was like, he was very hard. And then Dobby the House Elf was very fun to do. My kids always liked Dobby.
Did you have any Scottish accents in there?
Oh, yes, of course. Professor McGonagall. Professor McGonagall had a Scottish voice, of course. Harry.
That's good. All right, guys. Natasha Romanoff, a.k.a. Black Widow, versus Jason Bourne. Who would win that matchup and why?
Jason Bourne.
Jason Bourne, probably.
Jason Bourne, okay.
Because his choreography is better.
He's got a better fight choreographer.
Yep.
I mean, I just think of, you know, when I think of both of those characters, I think of, like, fighting in a physical way, and then I think Jason Bourne wins. Sorry, Black Widow.
Finally, the 12 spies to Canaan or Jack Bauer?
Wow, that's really good. Jack Bauer. No, I'm going to take that back. I'm going to take that back because 10 of the 12 spies were worthless. There were only two left that were faithful. And so they saw optimism and hope at taking the promised land. And two is better than one Jack Bauer, so I got to go with the spies to Canaan.
I'll agree with that.
Even though they did visit a prostitute, but we won't talk about that.
But all spies visit prostitutes. It's what they do.
It's a great place to hang out and hide.
I'm going to answer that one too because I think it's clever. I think Jack Bauer would lose that matchup because he doesn't have a cell phone.
Well, at least the government's not tapping into him.
Yep, right. What's your guys' favorite? Do you guys have a favorite spy movie before getting to Trump versus Pope?
Oh, favorite spy. You know what? I have a few. I really liked. It's one of the very few Robert Redford movies I've ever really liked. But I liked Spy Game with Robert Redford and Brad Pitt.
Oh, that was a great movie.
That was a really excellent movie. I really loved Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, except for the last 10 minutes of it. The last 10 minutes, the whole mood of the film changed, and it was really jarring. But up to that point, Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy was superb.
Hadley?
I like Ethan Hunt. I like the Mission Impossible series. I also really like James Bond, and I know he's not that great of a guy, just character-wise. James Bond, he sleeps around too much for my taste, but he's an excellent spy, and I can understand why the ladies want him. I mean, he's got something very appealing.
I've always wondered, can somebody answer this? I'm not a huge James Bond aficionado, but I keep hearing all this stuff about what a great spy he is. I can't figure out why in every James Bond movie he goes to the location, right, where he's going to do his spying, and he introduces himself by his name. I mean, isn't he like world-renowned James Bond, the spy, and he keeps showing up and saying Bond, James Bond.
Apparently.
Like, how good of a spy can you be?
Apparently, there are new criminals that don't know of his renown.
Yeah, I'm sure. Apparently. Right.
I really enjoyed Man from U.N.C.L.E. I remember watching that series back in the day, but I like those.
See that.
I like those period films. It's super fun. It's an adult movie, but it's super fun. And then one of my favorites growing up was Spies Like Us with Chevy Chase and Dan Aykroyd.
The Man Who Knew Too Little.
Bill Murray. Classic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, enough of that ridiculous random conversation.
Let's move on to more ridiculous conversation.
Yes, more ridiculous conversation, something actually true. Trump versus a pope. Once again, businessman Donald Trump has sucked all the oxygen of media attention to himself, and this time it wasn't his fault. Apparently, a reporter asked the pope to comment on some of Donald's rhetoric about immigration, and the pope said something to the effect that, I can't do a Latin accent, that doesn't sound very Christian. Instant headlines. You know what the headlines were? Pope says Trump not a Christian and that sort of thing. So, can Trump get any crazier? Like, all of a sudden, he just wants to sort of... Okay, he didn't pick this fight, but now he did. He's fighting with everybody. Comments?
Surely, Hadley, on one of your cable news appearances, you guys have talked about this, because it's all anybody's talking about. So, you've got some, you know, pre-planned things to say about it, don't you?
Huh. Well, the cable news discussion is always going to be, how does this change the race, or how does this affect the race? And the perspective I shared yesterday on Fox was, it doesn't. You know, people have already made up their mind about Donald Trump. There may be a handful of Catholics in South Carolina that they think, you know, this is interesting, but I don't think it necessarily even changes how they vote. So, okay. You know, because there's been so much discussion about Donald Trump and his faith and his history and his behaviors and his positions. This is not anything new. My personal perspective on what the Pope actually said, and this we didn't really get into on cable news because, you know, I get to talk for 30 seconds and then I'm done. But I thought that the Pope's comments, I agreed with them. Because I don't think that the Pope was necessarily trying to make a statement about immigration policy so much as he was trying to make a statement about the rhetoric that Trump has been using, and that as Christians, we should be about building bridges in a metaphorical sense, that we should be about extending with open arms the message of Christ and the love of Christ, and that we should be more about that than we should be about building walls. Again, not physical walls, but walls in a figurative sense around ourselves, our communities, our faith, that, you know, people who are more about building walls than building bridges are not acting in a Christ-like way. I kind of agree with that. And I don't think that that's necessarily a condemnation of Donald Trump or saying that he is not a Christian. Maybe it was intended to be that way, but I don't think that this was a discussion of policy so much as other people have taken it to be.
Yeah, Hadley, I agree. I took the Pope's comments completely, and maybe this is just, I mean, maybe this is a feature of being a theologian. I mean, I just kind of read it through these lenses, and I saw the question that was asked of the Pope, and I thought, the Pope is answering a question about virtue and character, and everybody's interpreting it as an answer about public policy. Talk about totally missing each other. They were really asking him, this guy's running around saying, kick everybody out, build a wall, you know, and this. And the Pope is responding to really the heart attitude behind the kind of person who's constantly dividing people that way and building walls. And that's kind of what the Pope is thinking about. And that's what he's critical of, rightly critical of. He should be rightly critical of somebody who's just trying to be divisive. I read the Pope as saying, no, we should actually not be divisive. We should be open and into unity. Of course the Pope is going to say that, right?
Can I ask Brian two questions here? And I'd like Jay's input.
Cue the Ask a Theologian music.
Ask a Theologian. Da, 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 da.
I'm being put on the spot here.
Yeah, well, I'm curious what you have to say about the papacy and the role of the Pope in the world and how we should think about the Pope as Protestant Christians. And then my second question...
Well, that's not a thorny can of worms.
Well, if you can give a
okay, what's your
short
second question?
Answer. My second question is it ever appropriate, and under what circumstances is it appropriate for a Christian in a place of authority to say of someone else, this person is not a Christian?
Oh, big Woo! Question.
Cue the end of the show.
Wow.
I'm sorry. These are the kinds of things that I've been thinking about.
These are fantastic.
I'm a Christian theologian who stands very, very firmly in the Reformation tradition. I am not a Roman Catholic.
That's why I'm asking you.
I do not agree with, nor do I submit to Rome's claim of supremacy in terms of the Christian Church. I deny its exclusivity, and so to me, the Pope saying things is akin or equivalent to a pastor or a theologian of great note saying things. I don't have the sort of skin in the game that Roman Catholics do. When the Pope speaks for a Roman Catholic, they have definitely more at stake in what you think about the Pope, what the Pope says. And they have various ways of, you know, it was the Pope speaking about faith or morals, or was just this just a personal opinion about policy? And they make all kinds of distinctions about when the Pope is speaking authoritatively, right? And, you know, so anyway, they have a way of distinguishing that. To me, he's always just speaking as a fallible pastor or theologian. And so with regard to the Pope, anything that he says as a Reformed Christian, I take anything that he says and hold it to the light of the Word of God. If it's in agreement with the Bible, then I affirm it. If it's not, I don't. Because I'm a Protestant. I believe in sola scriptura, that the Bible is the sole infallible Word of God. So I definitely appreciated the thoughts of Benedict the 16th more than I do Francis the 1st, because Benedict was a legit theologian, very well schooled, very educated. He was a really excellent theologian. Francis the 1st is not a theologian. He's a pastor, and he talks too much, and he gets baited into questions like this. So does that answer your question as to what
would
I
it be
feel?
Wrong to would it be wrong to boil down your answer to something like, we view the Pope as a very prominent pastor, religious leader in Catholicism?
No, I don't think that would be wrong. You know, there's a lot of
religion
debate.
As a whole,
obviously,
though,
there's
as well.
A lot of there still remains a lot of division and divisive debate between Roman Catholicism and Protestantism. There are certain wings of Protestantism that doesn't believe that the Roman Catholic Church is Christian at all. It's not, you know, it's the Antichrist. There are still those segments. That's been waning a lot in recent years, and I certainly don't belong to that camp. Yes, I actually believe that Rome is a true church. I don't believe it's a healthy one. That's
honestly,
that's what
frankly, I see a lot of divisions inside of the Catholic Church.
Yes,
I mean, I know that there's supposed to be one church and one, you know, denomination, we might call it, but there seems to be a lot of division, especially when the Pope says something like this, or when the Pope says something about climate change, yeah, or social justice, or what have you, that there's a lot of Catholics who disagree with what,
yeah,
the Pope
and I'm gonna,
says.
You know what's going to happen now is I'm going to get inundated by emails from Roman Catholics wanting to relitigate the Protestant Reformation. You'd be surprised at how often this happens, and they want to argue about the papacy and tell me that Rome is the one true church, and you know I'm not going to relitigate all that, but you know, you bring up a good point. They're often telling us, look at how disorganized and all the diversity in Protestantism and all the different denominations, and you know, that only gets you so far, because I see Roman Catholic institutions like universities filled with professors, often of the Jesuit order, who don't believe anything of the Christian faith. They don't even believe that Jesus rose from the dead, right? So don't talk to me about diversity until Rome actually doesn't just have institutional unity, but actually has organic grassroots unity. They don't. Your second question, when is it appropriate for a pastor to say this person is not a Christian? It's not.
Or if ever. Yeah.
I was going to follow up on that one a little bit, that, you know, Scripture talks quite a bit, both in Matthew, James, and other passages, about what's in your heart is what is coming out. But to declare somebody not a, most people, unless you are their pastor, are not going to know that relationship or that heart nearly as well as you could. So I'm always really cautious when people come out and say, oh, this person's not a believer. This person's like, I have suspicions about a lot of folks like that don't right. uphold, as Brian said, to sola scriptura. Do you actually live, do your ideals, what you're teaching actually line up with what Scripture says? There are a lot of Christian teachers out there that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
But
I want to go a little bit further. The reason I said never isn't because we can't judge whether somebody is a Christian or not, because the crucial point in your question is, when is it okay for an individual religious leader or pastor to declare this? I'm not a Roman Catholic, but I do believe in the church. And I do believe there's an institution of the church, and there's an institutional role for the church. If your question is, should an individual pastor be declaring somebody outside of the faith? No, I don't think that's somebody has the jurisdiction to do that. God judges the heart. However, the church does have authority to declare people outside of the Christian faith. It does believe in excommunication. It does teach that, you know, if you're not a professing believer, if you're not baptized, and if you're not a member of the church, then you're unrepentant. You are outside the Christian faith. And I think that's an institutional role for the church. So I think individual people speaking on their own ought to be really careful about that kind of rhetoric. Now,
but even still, Brian, that only really happens, like at our church, that would only happen if somebody has been involved with our leadership for a long time,
sure,
to work through and try to help them get to the repentance part, help them understand the faith. And that never happens. And there's, you know, and that's when, but that's only after you spend time getting to know somebody, getting to know their heart. And it's in that particular.
Yeah. Discipline has to occur in that kind of a context.
Yeah.
I was just saying people should be really cautious about just, you know, declaring somebody, you know, outside the Christian
faith. Or just don't.
However, I say this as somebody who just wrote a lengthy piece on Donald Trump, in which I didn't say Donald Trump's not a Christian. I did say that if you read the Bible, you'll see that Donald Trump exhibits all of the characteristics of the fool in the Bible. When it talks about wisdom and foolishness, Donald Trump is really a fool. If you just go down the ledger and look at it. I didn't make any fundamental final declaration about the state of the man's heart. However, I can listen to his own testimony. When Donald Trump says, I have never felt the need to ask God for forgiveness. I think that actually sort of is a self-indictment that you're not a Christian, right? Because what is the first thing Jesus says when he arrives? The very, very first words he says in his public ministry. He says, the kingdom of heaven is near. Repent and believe the good news. Right? Repent. That's the first step of what being a Christian is all about. And Donald says, I haven't repented. I've never felt the need to repent.
I don't, you know, when people, people have asked me about certain... Yeah, people have asked me about certain leadership, certain public people, and I've been like, you know, their teaching on X doesn't line up with what Scripture says, or their comments or something, or even that's almost a personal testimony.
But that's not the same thing as reading somebody's heart and saying, I know what their relationship with the Lord is.
Because we don't.
But when somebody tells me I've never asked God for forgiveness, I can go, okay, you pretty much, you're not really understanding Christianity.
Well, previous to this discussion about Donald Trump and whether or not he's a Christian, I think there's been a lot of attention over the past 7-8 years about President Obama, whether or not he's a Christian.
Right.
You know, that's kind of been where a lot of the discussion has been. And I think, you know, that makes me uncomfortable. I like the points that Annette made on the live stream, you know, and this was the first thing that came to my mind, basically that you judge a tree by its fruit, you know, and it's not really my place to say if someone's a Christian or not, but I do think you can see the fruit of the Spirit in the lives of so many Christians. When you don't see any fruit in someone's life, I think that's concerning.
Right.
Especially
Jesus
who's
tells
trying
us
to be a leader
and
take a leadership role.
Right?
But I still don't think that that's, you know, I don't think that that's enough to say that person is not a Christian.
Right.
Because again, you know, what's in their heart and what God is doing in their heart, it's a mystery to me, you know. But I've thought a lot about President Obama and about some of the things that people have said about him over the years, whether or not he's a Christian. Obviously, there are some people, you know, I don't know for sure, but I imagine that Senator Sanders, since he says he's Jewish, that we can safely say that he is not a Christian, if that is...
Joshua's listening right now on the live stream. He could probably tell us.
I think Sanders would probably not claim to be a Christian if he's Jewish.
Right. Right. So if someone doesn't profess to be a Christian, then we can safely say,
not
a Christian, right?
Sure. But at the same
time, then if someone professes that they are a Christian, then that becomes, for me, that becomes a very difficult thing
well,
to navigate.
Well, it's at that point where you have to look at the fruits and judge. I mean, that's the thing is Jesus, everybody says Jesus didn't say to judge. No, Jesus didn't say that. He said, be very careful about the standard by which mm-hmm. you judge.
Well, and I think it's one thing to judge if someone's a Christian or not, and it's another thing to judge if this person is suited for leadership.
Right.
And so, you know, there's...
I can say this.
Even when Mitt Romney was running as a candidate, I had concerns about his faith because he's not a Mormon, you know? And so I thought, we have some differences theologically, but I think he would make a better leader than our current president mm-hmm. for various reasons. So
you run into
this.
Being a good, being a Christian doesn't automatically make you a good leader and vice versa.
No, definitely not. No, definitely
not. We know this.
I think we could go back. One thing, Hadley, about Barack Obama's claim to be a Christian is I would have to go back and take a look at the church that he belonged to for 20 years in Chicago. I can pretty confidently say, knowing the theology and the worldview taught at, Trinity United Church or whatever it was called, pastored by Jeremiah Wright. Jeremiah Wright is a process theologian. This is really a heretical branch of Christianity that turns all of the great redemptive realities of Christianity, salvation from our sins, forgiveness of sins, liberation from the bondage of sin, all of the great truths of the Christian faith get refracted through the lens of Marxism. And so redemption and liberation becomes economic redemption or liberation or racial liberation. It's a flattening, and it's turning all the great otherworldly realities of Christianity into this worldly utopian realities. That's what process theology does. And black liberation theology is a subset of process theology. And I can pretty confidently say as a theologian, that's not real Christianity when you turn all of the great spiritual truths of Christianity into a this-worldly political program. That's the church that Barack Obama belonged to. And it's so interesting that that's sort of his political bent, too.
Can someone be a Christian and also have heresies that they believe in?
Sure.
And can Christians...
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure. And that's those are very... There's always gray areas, right? There's always gray areas. And so there's people in the church who claim to be Christians who are not, right? I mean, there's always the branch not bearing fruit that's going to be cut off, right? I mean, there's plenty of warnings about that in the Bible. On the other hand, there may be people that are in a substandard church or maybe even a heretical church who actually may have a vital living union with Jesus Christ in a personal relationship, and they may really be Christians. So there's a blend, it's blurry, but, you know, so we can paint in broad strokes, but you want to be very careful about saying about somebody, an individual person, what the state of their heart is with the Lord.
Yeah. Sorry, Jay, for
that was awesome.
Hijacking the conversation with my
point
asking Brian those things.
That's what I love about this show, because, you know, it's in case you haven't figured it out, we talk a healthy dose about culture, but are not afraid to tackle the more spiritual Christian matters surrounding these issues. And so I appreciate that, Hadley, very much. Guys, before we close the show, what are your predictions for the South Carolina primary on Saturday?
Oh, no.
Is Josh totally trolling me? He is totally trolling
me. Yeah, after Remley tried baiting you into Bovink. Brian, back to topic.
I'm going to go bold. I'm going bold, okay? You want South Carolina predictions? I'm going to give you South Carolina predictions. And this is, I am going so far out on a limb here that it is going to be totally, totally embarrassing how wrong I am, or this is going to be absolute genius when it comes true. You guys ready?
Let's hear it.
Coming in fourth place on Saturday in South Carolina will be John Kasich with 11% of the vote.
Goodness, these are
coming
specific predictions.
Coming in third place in South Carolina is going to be Ted Cruz with 18% of the vote. coming in second place in South Carolina with 23% of the vote, Donald J. Trump. Coming in first place in a remarkable surprise comeback victory will be Marco Rubio with 25% of the vote, all others in single digits.
Rubio with endorsements from South Carolina Governor Haley, South Carolina Senator Tim Scott, and South Carolina Congressman Trey Gowdy. That Marco Rubio, is that who you're talking about?
That's the one, I'm talking about.
Won the sweepstakes of endorsements from the Palmetto State.
I'm holding out for a surprise victory.
Man, Brian's going basically all or nothing. It sounds like I'm going to hit because I want to either be right or be happy.
She's got to say it again because I think I missed it. You broke up a
little bit. Breakups there.
That's some digital breakups. Say it again.
I said I'm going to sort of hedge here because I want to either be right or be happy. So
okay. I went bold.
So I'm gonna predict a Trump victory in South Carolina. That'll be if I'm right.
Okay.
I will be unhappy, but I will be right. But I think it will be very close. I think the polls showing him way out in front are not accounting for the fact that, you know, who turns are the people who get to decide how the primary goes. And I think there's a lot of people who say they support Donald Trump, but I don't think they'll turn out in the same numbers that they answer the polls. So I'll put him closer to about 20%. Taking the plurality of the votes. But then I think it'll be Cruz and Rubio on his tail, both of them, very close.
Who's, come on, you gotta pick a second place.
You mean which one on top?
Cruz or Rubio?
Well, I think Rubio could edge out Cruz. I think that could happen.
Okay.
I think he's had the momentum on his side, the Marco momentum. So, I'll say Trump, Rubio, and then Cruz. So if we have something in common, Brian, it's a third place finish for Cruz.
I think that's what we're going to have in common, yeah.
Yeah, and then after that, I agree with you that Kasich will come in fourth too because, I'll change that.
You think Carson?
Maybe Bush will come in fourth.
Bush, yeah.
No, I think Bush will come in fourth. You know, Bush has made a real effort to do outreach to military and veterans in South Carolina, which are a huge part of the Republican vote in that state.
Right.
He's brought his brother down to campaign for him. He's tried to present himself as the anti-Trump in a lot of ways. George W. Bush, extremely popular with Republicans in South Carolina. So I think there'll be some people who vote for Bush just... But this, I think this will be Bush's last stand.
I disagree that Bush will take fourth place, and the reason is I really believe that his voters are looking for the exits. I really do. I think they know the campaign's over. He's on his last legs, and he's not going anywhere. And I really do think they're going to move in substantial numbers and not vote for him. I don't see a fourth place.
But they're not going to. They're not going to vote for Trubio. They're not going to vote for Trump. They're going to move to Rubio.
They will move to Rubio, I think. And that's why I'm predicting.
Honestly, I think everybody who drops out from here forward, I'd say 90% of their votes go to Rubio.
Yeah, that's my
view. I just think if you were going to vote for Cruz, you would have done it by now. If you were going to support Trump, you would have done it by now.
And if you're voting for Bush,
you're looking at hard ceilings, and Rubio's got room to grow. But I think Kasich's problem, especially in a state like South Carolina, is that number one, he doesn't have name recognition. So there's a lot of people who just frankly don't know who he is. And number two, I mean, if there's a case to be made that anybody in this race is not really a conservative, it's John Kasich. I mean, if there's any argument to be made that there's like this Republican establishment that caves on important issues, it would be Medicaid expanding John Kasich from
Ohio. But you just said if there's a case to be made about anybody not being conservative, it's John Kasich. You're totally wrong. It's Donald Trump, about whom you could make the case as not a conservative.
I guess I was thinking from the perspective of those voters who might support someone like Trump, because they're always saying we need somebody who's going to be strong and effective and not a squish.
Right.
You know? And so I guess what I mean is if there's anybody who's a squish, it's John Kasich.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with you.
I don't think Donald Trump's very squishy, but you're right. He's not a conservative.
Well, guys, we will convene next week.
And we will know. We will know how all this goes.
It'll either be a great show.
Depressing.
An okay show or a depressing show.
If I hit my top four and if I come very close to the numbers that I just threw out there, then I'm gonna be like drinking champagne on the show. Just
well, otherwise you'll be asking for a night show so he can be like crying in his whiskey or something.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Scotch. If Brian is right, I might pop champagne too, because that means Donald Trump has not won in South Carolina.
That's right.
Yeah. Good. Okay, guys, that was a good show. if you want to know when we're doing this again, jump on to www.deadreckoning.tv and sign up for either our mailing list or follow us on one of our social media accounts, either Facebook or Twitter. We will advertise in the days prior. Usually our show falls on a Thursday or Friday. Times can vary. So that said, Hadley, where can people follow you and keep in touch with what you're talking about and what appearances you make in the media while we are away?
Well, I work for the Independent Women's Forum. I don't speak for them when I do Dead Reckoning Radio, but you can visit their website, which is iwf.org, and under the TV tab, you can see a lot of my prior interviews and appearances on Fox and other networks. If you want to pay attention to what I'm going to be on next, I would encourage you to follow me on Twitter, because that's where I usually post, usually within 5 minutes of a hit, very late notice. I'll let my Twitter followers know that I'm going to be on, but my Twitter handle is @HadleyHeath, and I speak for myself on my Twitter as well, so I share lots of opinions.
Awesome. Brian?
Well, you can find me at drbrianmattson.com. You can go like my public Facebook page at Dr. Brian G. Mattson. And my Twitter handle is @BrianGMattson. That's where you can find me.
Well, thanks for joining us, guys. Again, www.deadreckoning.tv to follow all of our stuff, our Instagram accounts, our Facebook accounts, our Twitter accounts, and we even occasionally put up a blog post or three. I'm your host, Jay Friesen. And that's Brian Mattson, and that's Hadley Heath. And if you like us on iTunes and or Google Play, please rate us four or five stars. We are currently all 5 stars. I think we have about 9 reviews. It helps us get into those algorithm things for the search. And shout out to our sponsor, ADF Legal, Lines Defending Freedom. www.adflegal.org. Jump on their site, send them a note, send them a donation, tell them thank you for sponsoring our show. If you'd like to sponsor or know somebody who would like to sponsor, please holler at us. hello@deadreckoning.tv. That said, it's been a great week. Hopefully next week is great, because Saturday comes out well for all of us conservative types. If you're liberal, thanks for listening. Take care.